brought to you by Penguin.
Audiobook of the Year 2019 by No Such Thing as a Fish. Read by James Harkin, Andrew Hunter Murray, Anna Ptaszynski, and Dan Schreiber.
Hello and welcome to the Audiobook of the Year 2019. My name is Dan Schreiber. I am sitting here with Andrew Hunter Murray, Anna Ptaszynski, and James Harkin, and we are four fact nerds who host a weekly podcast called No Such Thing as a Fish. And once again, we have gathered around the microphones to tell you about the most interesting things that have happened on your planet in the last 12 months.
That is correct. So if any of you out there are just sick of reading the same old news stories, fear not, we're not going to cover them. We are going to tell you about the stuff that you might have missed, like the weirdest, wackiest stuff out there. So things like the fact that three new lawnmower records were set this year.
Wow.
Yeah, pretty big deal. Or that a winner of the first ever heavy metal knitting championship was crowned. Big stuff like that.
We might mention one or two things about the big news of the year. So we might mention a few things about Trump, I suppose.
Oh, yeah.
I think climate change might get a look in.
Yeah, definitely.
But there will be absolutely no mention of... Oh.
Ooh.
What was that?
I don't know.
So I'll try it again. You know, the debate between Britain and the EU about the membership, and that, of course, we refer to as... It's happened again.
Okay, oh. That's weird. Maybe they'll fix that glitch.
There'll be no mention of anyway in the book. It's not going to happen.
Yeah.
So it won't be relevant.
It won't be relevant, but I guess if anything slips in, hopefully that little noise will remain and you'll know that that's what we're talking about.
Why do you say remain, Dan?
Wait, is this subconscious propaganda? This is bullshit.
Just looking at the list of articles, there's news about whales and wigs and bees and Bezos and pigs and post and creepy crawlies, all sorts of stuff. It's all in there. Weird articles full of fabulous news.
Indeed. And you said bees and Bezos and pigs and what was the other one beginning with
post?
P? Post, yes. And that gives you a clue that this is actually a book in alphabetical order. We'll be going through all 26 letters, one at a time, but actually... there may be some of the letters that aren't recorded in this very room where we're recording at the moment.
Yep, that's right. We are going to record some of our chapters or some of our letters or just some of our extracts on the road as part of our live tour. It's basically a cheat, so we don't actually have to come up with an actual live show. We're just going to read some of the bits from this book and then we're going to insert them in here. So if you hear audiences laughing raucously or booing heinously, then it's not because we've invited 1,000 people into our recording studio. That would be very distracting. It's because we're doing the live show.
That's right. And we should say before we begin that we would like to thank all of the incredible journalists around the world who've made it possible for this audiobook to exist. And we're talking about everyone from the Birmingham Post to the New York Times, from Meat Management Magazine to the Uranus Examiner. If we didn't have them finding all the incredible stories that you're about to hear, we would be nothing. So thank you to them.
Okay, that's it from us. We hope you enjoy the book and we will see you on the other side of it for the credits.
On with the audiobook.
A. In which we learn which motorists were disappointed to see the AA, who had Noah Luck insuring their boat, which world leader turned down a $5 note, who didn't want to be sent flowers, and who absolutely shouldn't bother flying up a supervillain's bottom.
Or. Two tourists planning to visit the Norwegian village of Or ended up 1,310 kilometres away in awe.
Doesn't awe begin with O?
It does sound that way, doesn't it? What a confusing way to start the audiobook. But does audiobook begin with O, James?
You're quite right, it doesn't.
Exactly.
Very good point. Can you spell out these O's?
Can you spell out every word you say from now on?
Certainly, yeah, it might take a bit longer. So OR is a Norwegian letter which is spelled AA, sort of capital A, small a, sometimes, or it's alternatively spelled sort of like an English A with a little weird blob on top of the A.
It's called a hat, technically, I believe.
Is it? Mm. It's like the little ring on top of a Christmas bauble. You could hang it on a tree.
Yes. Bauble, demonstrating the or sound.
Yes.
So, yes, it is a confusing way to start the audiobook, but essentially it's the last letter in the Norwegian alphabet, but it looks like the first letter in ours. And basically these two tourists, these Chinese travellers, were spotted by Orr's deputy mayor. They were literally in her front yard, and she realised they had mistakenly put Orr, one spelling, into their sat-nav, and they'd actually intended to go to Orr, the other spelling.
So which spelling was she living in?
Yeah, was it Orr or Orr?
It was all James.
Okay. Yeah.
So yes, it was in a one of the Orrs, the place they ended up, was in a village called Haien, which is more than 1,300 kilometers south of Orr. And since the tourists didn't speak Norwegian, they were Chinese tourists, and the deputy mayor didn't speak Mandarin, she was completely unable to help them. And in the midst of the confusion, actually, it probably didn't help that the deputy mayor's name was Orr Berger. So spelled with another Orr.
A third Orr?
It's a third Orr, yeah. The tourist vanished before anyone could do anything about it.
If you're on a date in a boat, you don't want to be the third Orr, do you? There'll be a lot more of those puns as this book goes on.
Adventuring. A 71-year-old Frenchman crossed the Atlantic in a barrel without a paddle or an engine or any sails or any oars. Jean-Jacques Savin, a 71-year-old former paratrooper and sailor, wanted to become the first person to rely solely on currents to cross the Atlantic. So he built himself a 10-foot-long plywood barrel. It was designed to be killer whale-proof, weighted to stay upright, clever, and his bed had straps so he wouldn't fall out in the night.
Was he sleeping on top of the barrel?
He was sleeping inside the barrel.
Oh, okay.
But
so just falling out of his bed as opposed to
falling out of
the Atlantic.
Falling into the sea, yeah. He thought of everything. Savin cast off from the Canary Islands on Boxing Day last year, and he hoped to make it to the Caribbean within 3 months. Things did not go quite to plan. He was blown 600 miles off course almost immediately, and the weather remained against him for 5 weeks. On the upside, as there was no need to spend time maintaining an engine or all the sails he didn't have, he was able to dedicate himself to writing a diary, playing the mandolin, and looking at passing fish through a porthole in the bottom of the barrel. Although he also had to spend 3 hours a day replying to emails forwarded to him by his secretary. As any good Frenchman would, he celebrated his 72nd birthday with foie gras and a bottle of Bordeaux. Finally, after 2,930 miles and 4 months of bobbing around on the ocean, Savin made it to the Caribbean Sea. He was then given a tow by a friendly oil tanker to the nearest land, the Dutch island of St. Eustatius, some 230 miles away. Although that wasn't his plan, he had been hoping to end up on a French-owned island because, as he said, that would be easier for the paperwork. For his next challenge, Savin is thinking of crossing the Pacific in a barrel. His friends are trying to dissuade him.
Amazon versus Amazon. Amazon attempted to bribe the Amazon with $5 million worth of Kindles. 25 years ago, Jeff Bezos decided to change the name of his nascent company, Kadabra.com, after a conference call when people misheard it as Cadaver. He finally hit on Amazon.com. The Amazon is the largest river in the world, he said, and he wanted to build the largest bookshop in the world. Amazon.com is certainly now the world's largest bookshop, but Bezos still wants it to expand. And to help him meet this ambition, he hatched a plan to create websites that, instead of ending .com, end with .amazon. Unfortunately, that idea didn't go down well with the governments of Bolivia, Brazil, Colombia, Ecuador, Guyana, Peru, Suriname, and Venezuela, all of whom argued that since the River Amazon runs through their countries, they should own the rights to web addresses that make use of its name. At one stage, Amazon.com offered these countries $5 million worth of Kindles to try to break the impasse. The gesture was rejected, and the matter was eventually turned over to the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers, also known as ICANN. After 5 years of wrangling, ICANN finally judged in favour of Amazon.com, but with the proviso that each country the Amazon runs through will be allowed a single domain name ending in .amazon. They will also be able to request a veto to up to 1,500 web addresses. What the ruling did not reveal was whether or not they still get the Kindles.
Do you think if you're very good looking and you work at ICANN, you get called eye candy?
Not in the Me Too era, yeah. I don't think.
You have been more suited to the late 70s, I think.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.